everyone. My name is Melanie Heisey, and this is my neurobiology final project. So, what is happening here? Well, we have two people walking. That decision to walk would start in the neocortex.
Walking is a very stereotyped action, so it's pretty much the central pattern generators located in the brainstem sending messages down your spinal cord to your muscles.
Your balance is simultaneously continually accommodated for by your brainstem. And you walk almost unconsciously, leaving you plenty of brain power left to worry about whether your hands are sweaty and you look stupid, or whether or not they really like you. The other action happening here, gripping hands, also starts in the neocortex, where you decide to do it.
It might go through the cerebellum to become a practiced habit, when you'll still perform on default when you're old and gray together. You've got touch coming in to somatosensory cortex, activated in the skin and passing through the spinal cord. Make sure that you do just what you want to, is the basal ganglia.
But the physical actions are probably the least important part of what's going on here. What are people in this picture feeling? Oxytocin, commonly called the love hormone, is probably involved. It is associated with trust, social bonding, and childbirth, though that's only for women.
It's one of the behavior modulators regulated by the hypothalamus, the head of the limbic system. Mirror neurons make a partner's smiles part of your own happiness. Hopefully, you're genuinely happy, something that would take a path to your face through the extrapyramidal pathways, producing a genuine smile with crinkles in the edges. You're also paying attention to little things about your partner, using your thalamus that is so well-trained, paying attention to social signals. You're comprehending the subtext of your interactions with the area corresponding to Broca's area in the right hemisphere. You display body language both intentionally with the homologue of Wernicke's area and as byproduct of your own emotions.
Whoops! Did I just make it unromantic by explaining it all?
Personally, I think a beautiful moment is a beautiful moment, and you can only add to that beauty by understanding what's really going on beneath the surface.
Back to the subject of this project, I highly recommend taking this course. The Everyday Neurology course has not brought me a great amount of new knowledge, to be honest. My interest in the brain precedes taking this course. What it has done is infinitely more valuable. It created a context for bringing this knowledge together. I come at a lot of this information from the standpoint of social or clinical psychology, and the course really opened my eyes to how these isolated facts together form the basis of a whole different perspective from which to understand what a person is. It started at the lowest level of how the nervous system operates to the more abstract levels of everyday functioning. I now find myself curious in a direction I wasn't before, like about how autism is thought of as a different brain wiring. But do we know what specific neurological bits have altered functioning? And what exactly is going on when I meditate? What parts of my brain am I strengthening? And how does this correspond to the internal narrative of meditation? Nothing I've come across looking at these questions is as organized as what Professor Mason presented, so I have some digging to do yet.